I am totally touched. Totally touched. I count it a privilege to stand behind here. I really do. A privilege and an honor. And I'm going to share my heart out today. And hopefully I'll be able to get through this. But I believe that God has something for us very special. We have been through a lot individually and as a church as well. And Pastor was sharing a couple of weeks ago, for a couple of weeks, about what to do when trials come. And where do you go? And you run to God because God is our refuge. He's my refuge. He's my fortress. And so Pastor asked me to share something. And I went to God right away. God, what am I going to say? God, what am I going to say? What do you got to say? So there are a couple of things that I want to share. And can I come down here? I want to be close to you guys. I want to be close to you guys. I hope you guys don't get nervous, okay? But I'm going to share my heart out, and let's see what God has for us. But everything that we do has to be anchored in the bedrock that God is good.
Yes, it does.
Everything. So that has to be the lens through which we see anything that happens to us. God is good. God is good. Everything that he does is good. So, as Pastor said before, Moses was asking God, God, we're having a great thing here going on. I want to see your glory now. Yeah. God, I want to see your glory. And God says, okay, I like you enough that I'm going to show you something really really powerful to you. But before I go any further, let me define properly this glory thing that you want to seek. Because you and I would have said, hey, I want to see your glory. And it would have been cool if God would have taken you in a vision and boom, and showed you all the gold that he has. And he would have shown you all the New Jerusalem with paved streets that are made of solid gold and the pearly gates. And he would have shown you in a moment of flight, in a flash of time, all the power that he has, how he spoke, and all the universe, the galaxy came into being. Now that would impress you, right? That would impress you. Instead, God didn't say that. He says in Exodus 33, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. And I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. You want to see my glory? I'm going to show you my goodness. And so the next day, Moses could hardly wait for that. So he had an appointment with God. And so he got up early, the Bible says, and he went to the mountain. And that's something really, really amazing. Because chapter 34 of Exodus 5 and 7. Now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. He didn't say and whispered. Sometimes we read something and I think that we go a little too fast. But God himself stood there with Moses and proclaimed. Can you imagine how loud that must have been? Can you imagine what kind of announcement that heaven was making? And the Bible says that God came down and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful, gracious, long-suffering, abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin. That's the name of the Lord. In a nutshell, when you say the name of the Lord, that is His very nature, at the very core, at the very essence of who God is. He is good. You understand? Like, He's powerful, absolutely. He's incredible. He's omnipresent, absolutely. He can do anything, absolutely. But at the very core of that, God, He's good. He's merciful. He's got a heart that cannot be measured because His heart is so big. He's so much love. In fact, the New Testament says that God is love. So if you want to describe who God really is, He's good and He's love. He's not a hard taskmaster. He's not a judge that is walking around with a stick waiting to beat you up every time you make a mistake. It's not somebody that is just waiting for you to fall so He can show you and say, I told you so. He's a good God. And His love. He doesn't have love. He is love. Big difference. Big difference. Because you can have love and have all kinds of other stuff. But when you are love, you are love. If we were to cut God in a million little pieces, every little piece of Him would be love. Because that's who He is. So we're saying all that. That has to be the bedrock, the foundation, the anchor of everything that we do and everything that we go through. We have to see our life through those lenses. Okay? God is good. Whatever He does is good. He is love. Okay? Now, Jesus Himself said that. I'm not just saying that. Somebody came to Jesus and says, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, why do you call me good? You know, there's no one good, but only one, God. Okay? So Jesus Himself confirmed there's only one good, God. So God is good. I got all kinds of pages. Don't worry, I'm not gonna be too long. Don't get scared by all those pages. Don't get scared. So there are things that happen to us because of the goodness of God that sometimes we can wrap our head around. Because somehow we have bought a notion that associates the goodness of God with our comfort. And somehow we think that if God is so good, then I should have an incredibly easy, peachy life. And everything should just be going absolutely smooth as glass. And I should have absolutely no hardship, no trial, nothing in my life. It should just be a piece of cake. God is into being good. And God is into having the best for you, but not into your comfort. Jesus describes the Father as a vine dresser in John 15. A vine dresser is one that goes and prunes the vines. Now, I'm in the wine business, so I know that information firsthand. But a vine will produce shoots from the root. And if the farmer leaves all those shoots untrained and all, let's say, 5 or 7 shoots, that vine will be totally stressed. And that vine might reach the point of actually shortening its life. The grapes that are going to grow from that vine are going to be small and not much flavor. It's just a fact of life. Okay? So the farmer goes ahead during springtime and actually cuts off a bunch of branches. Now, God does that with us. And He doesn't do that with branches that are not bearing fruit. But only those that are bearing fruit get pruned. He's the wine dresser, and every branch in Him that bears fruit, He prunes, that it may bear forth more fruit. You caught that, eh? That should be a thermometer in your life God, how come I don't go through any hard times these days? Everything is way too easy. What's going on? Because every branch in him that bears fruit, he prunes it so that he may bring forth more fruit. So God is not in our comfort, whereas he's into our best. And God loves you and I way, way, way too much to just neglect us and leave us like that. Just like a farmer loves his vines and his vineyard too much to just abandon a vineyard and just let it go rampant to do whatever he wants to do, he can't do that. So the farmer prunes the vine. In our particular case, we only leave two branches per vine. So if the vine has 6-7 branches, we cut off all the rest and we only leave 2 branches. And then on top of that, once the vine starts bringing forth grapes, we will actually go in the vineyard even more and remove some of the fruit, because that will produce better grapes, juicier, more flavorful, a better harvest, which means that we can make a better wine. God is not into quantity. He's into quality. He's into quality. Because what he wants from you is something that is so, so, so precious. That would be absolutely precious, precious, precious. So, having said all that, let me go now to a point. Go to Exodus chapter 30. We're making our way through here. We're almost done. Praise God. Everybody there? Verse 23 to verse 25. Also, take for yourself quality spices, 500 shekels of liquid myrrh. Everybody found it? Okay, Exodus 30, 23 to 25. So that's God giving Moses some instructions on making the anointing oil. Okay? Take for yourself quality spices, 500 shekels of liquid myrrh, half as much sweet-smelling cinnamon, 250 shekels, 250 shekels of sweet-smelling cane, 500 shekels of cassia, according to the shekel of the sanctuary, and a hin of olive oil. Say it right there, Joseph. What are you talking about? Bear with me. Stay with me. And you shall make from this a holy anointing oil, an ointment compounded according to the art of the perfumer. It shall be a holy anointing oil. And then you read the remaining of the chapter there. And everything in the sanctuary that was used in the ministry, in the worship, in the service of God, had to be smeared, anointed with that oil. From the very utensils that were being used to the very people that were ministering. You wanted to minister to God? You better have some of that anointing oil on you. You want to be singing? You better have some of that anointing oil on you. You want to be playing music? You better have some of that anointing oil on you, because everything in that sanctuary that was being used for the ministry and the worship of God had to be anointed with that oil. It couldn't be without that. It couldn't be. So we think that anointing oil is something that somebody lays hand on you and boom, you get it, you're zapped. I'm here to suggest something else. I'm here to say that anointing oil, it's a compound and a mixture and a coming together of all those things that happen in your life, that God blends them together and puts them all together, refines them, and makes a beautiful fragrance, and he puts that on you. And that qualifies you for you to minister. And that qualifies you for you to do anything in the service of God. Myrrh. You know what myrrh is? Myrrh is the bleeding, the oozing of a tree, a myrrh tree. When an incision is made in the branch, and the knife blade goes deeper than the bark and actually goes inside the sapwood, and it's a wound, and the tree starts to bleed. And so the tree starts to bleed, and this resin is produced, and this resin dries up. Amazingly, dries up like a teardrop. Like a teardrop. And that is harvested and ground up together, mixed with oil, and myrrh comes up. Incredibly fragrant. Has an aroma that is absolutely heady. It's like frankincense. It's absolutely amazingly wonderful. But it tastes so bitter. It's so, so nasty, bitter. You go through life and bad things happen to you. I was just reading a story just yesterday. Remember that song, Miracles, from Jesus Culture? I didn't know. But that song came from a deep time of sorrow. So this young man, used of God, goes through a time in his life where expecting a baby, the wife goes through 40 hours of labor. Can you imagine that? I can't even wrap my head around that. 40 hours of labor, and it's a stillborn. They had the church praying. They believe for a miracle, all that. And yet, it's a stillborn. What do you do with that? What do you do with that? What do you do when you've been praying for a child and nothing happens? Nothing happens. What do you do when all kinds of things happen to you that you can't explain? You say, God, I thought you were good. What is this mess that I'm going through? He is good. He is good. And whatever he does is good. He's just making a compound ointment in your life. And it needs some of the myrrh. Because if you haven't gone through hard times in your life, what are you going to give out? When somebody's got a broken heart, what are you going to give out? What are you going to say? God bless you. How far is that going to go? I'm not here to say that you need to be going through some hard time. No, I'm not here to say that at all. I'm here to say that when you're going through those hard times, when things just don't make sense, when you say, God, what's going on in my world? That is your perfect opportunity to embrace that and say, God, I cherish this, God, because you do all things good, all things well. You're doing something beautiful with my life, and this I offer up to you. A Christian walk is more than just everything peachy. It's a lot more than that. If you made your decision and if you made your commitment to really follow Jesus, follow God, your life will have disappointments. You will go through misunderstandings. You will go through that. You will experience betrayals. You will. When nobody understands you, and you feel like totally left out. You feel like so weird. Nobody wants to talk to you. You will go through that. You pray for something and it doesn't happen. Everybody around you gets so blessed and you don't. I went through a time one time where I went to a conference, my wife and I. And as God is my witness, all the money that we had, we spent it for that conference. We came back, and I didn't even have $5 to buy myself a bowl of soup. I've been there when my car is broken down and my wife is taking the bus because we had no other vehicle. And I couldn't go and got another car. I've been there. I've been there when my own family has turned against me. And so I had a brother that didn't talk to me for 3 years just because I gave him some good advice. I've been there. You know how it feels? It hurts. It stinking hurts. It really does. And in those times, believe me, you don't feel like jumping up and down and having a hallelujah time. You don't. Unless you're something special, then I need to come and touch you. But you don't. We are made of flesh and bones. And when we get cut, we bleed. When somebody speaks bad words about you, they hurt. They hurt. I know. We're tough. And so we say, those are only words. But you know what? Somehow those words play in our mind and they affect the way we see ourselves. And now our self-esteem is way, way, way low. It hurts. You've been praying for a job and you just can't find a job. You were in line for a promotion and you just got bypassed. What about me? What about me? That promotion should have been mine. It happens to us. It happens to us. Remember, God is good. Remember that. That's why I spent time before. Because all those things that happen to us, they have to be seen through the lens that God is good. And all that He does is good. He is love. So He can do bad things. Even if he tries, he can't do bad things. Because at the very core, at the very essence, his very nature, he is good. He is love. So he's got my good in mind. Cinnamon, sweet cane, cassia, all those things, those are all things that are produced from barks. And in many times, they actually remove the young shoots of a tree that they actually cultivate for that. They remove that and they actually peel the bark away. I'm telling you, Jesus said of his Father, of our Father, that he's the vine dresser. And every branch in him that bears forth fruit, he prunes it, that it may bring forth more fruit. So anointing, it's a compound. It's a compound. It's a compound. So I read the story of Chris Quilala. Yes. I read that. And out of that experience, you know what came out? An amazing song that God is the God of miracle. And I read that song. And I couldn't help but cry before reading about the story behind the song. I couldn't help but cry. Why? Because that song was birthed in pain, was birthed something from a deep encounter with God. And there was an anointing resting on that that actually could be transferred through a CD. So I'm listening to that and I'm crying. Totally crying. You know why some people can actually come and worship and whatever they sing just touches your heart? Oh. And then you got some people that have incredible talent and skill and they are singing away and it's not the same. You ever wonder what? Now, I appreciate so much that God said in that passage in Exodus, that all those spices needed to be mixed together according to the art of the perfumer. And aren't you glad that my father, your father, is not a shoemaker? No insult to shoemakers, absolutely none, okay? But you know what I'm saying. It's not a hacker. It's no one that just puts a fistful of this and a fistful of that and just hopes that something will come out. But it precisely measures all those ingredients together. And so it gives you enough pain, but it gives you more joy. Gives you more encounters with Him, where your heart is absolutely, totally melted away, and you experience His love and His nearness and His goodness in such a real way. And every once in a while, it sprinkles out with a little bit of hard time and a little bit of tears here and there. But it's not all tears. It's not all tears. You don't go through life always lamenting and always, oh God, oh, what am I, oh, I can't take, no. Your life is all scattered with all kinds of joyful moments when God has come through for you and you are so blessed that you're just worshiping God and words are not enough to say all that you are feeling for love, for God. It is. So God makes that anointing oil, and it's a precise mixture. Enough of this, and enough of that, and enough of that, according to the art of the perfumer. I'm so glad for that. Because many times, too much of one thing can actually destroy us. Too much love is no good, honestly. If you've been raised in a family where you had everything met, you just had to say, Dad, I want a car. And a car was there. Dad, I want a car. I want a house. And a house was there. How can you understand when you meet a friend and say, Joseph, I don't know how I'm going to make my mortgage payment this month. Will you pray for me? What are you going to pray? What are you going to give? And so we go through life and we peel a portion of our life and we give to others. And then we say, hey, I've been there. And the same God that did that for me, He can do it for you. And now you got faith. Now you can pray. There's a compassion. There's love. There's faith. And you can actually give something now. What do you say to I remember when the Global Awakening team was here and Katie shared about the story. Do you guys remember that? A little girl, little child, got sick, had the church praying, everybody praying for that. She died. And yet, I watched that little girl here, that woman here, little in stature, and she had an amazing heart of compassion. Compassion just oozed out of her. She could just come and just hug you, and without speaking a word, you just felt loved. Why is that? Because she has been through that. And now we comfort, Paul says, that with the same comfort that we have been comforted, now we also comfort others. Wrong page. Somewhere here. Thank you. Actually, it was. Thank you. Thank you. Psalm 111. Verse 65 and 68. You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. And then he says something else that is absolutely blows my mind away. And that's David, by the way. It is good for me that I've been afflicted, that I may learn your statutes. Let your tender mercy come to me that I may live, for your law is my delight. Let me bring this to a close. I can't find here. The Bible says about Joseph that God sent a man to save a nation and sent Joseph before. Joseph was the 11th of a wealthy family, the 11th child of a wealthy, well-to-do family. In our days, Joseph's family was not a middle-class family. They had herds, they had cattle, they had servants. There was a very well-to-do family. He was the 11th. He was the youngest, and he was a spoiled brat. Totally. Very much loved by his father, to the point that his father, Jacob, made a special coat for him. Was that good? Was that bad? I'm not sure. But Jacob loved Joseph so much. And so God gave Joseph a couple of dreams. And from a very early age already, God showed Joseph that he had a destiny and a purpose for this man that was normal, the common box, that Joseph himself could not even comprehend what this was all about. Not even Jacob, who had walked with God for so many years, knew what was going on. And so he had those amazing dreams that all his brothers and the sun and the moon are bowing down to him. And his brother said, what's this? You're going to rule over us? We'll show you something. To make a long story short, Joseph was sold. And you remember the story. He was sold. A just man, for no fault of his own, was sold. And he experienced some of the hardest times that any of us could have experienced. He experienced betrayal. He experienced reproach. He experienced being misunderstood, falsely accused. He experienced it all. And so he's cast in a prison. I found this little clip from the movie Joseph. I am a sucker for those movies, honestly. It's a Disney movie, and watch this scene. Lane, would you please show it? He had just interpreted the dreams, and he thought that was his ticket out. Lane, could we have the lights here off, please? Down. Thank you.
Guard! Tell them I'm still here! Answer me!
No one cares.
Osna.
Who's there?
No.
God, why are you doing this to me? Do you hear me? Any kindness you take away. You were the one who gave me the dreams. You brought me the gift. Some gift.
My dreams are lies.
What have I done to deserve this?
Sometimes that's all we have. Just a little flicker of hope.
I did what's right. I thought I had the answers. I thought I chose the surest road, but that road brought me here. So I put up a fight and told you how to help me. Now just when I have given up, the truth is coming clear. You know better than I. You know the way. I've let go the need to know why, for you know better than I. If this has been a test, I cannot see the reason, but maybe knowing I don't know is part of getting through. I try to do what's best, and faith has made it easy to see the best thing I can do is put my trust in you, for you know.
I love that. That little clip really captures the whole essence of what happened to Joseph. Captures the essence of what happens to us. So the call is, will you trust him? Will you trust the Father? And will you say, God, I don't know exactly what's going on, but I trust you. Will you trust God with your life? Will you trust God with your tomorrow? Will you trust God with your uncertainties and the things that you can't explain? Will you trust God for that? It's not a time to get bitter. It's not a time to become resentful. It's a time to dig in even closer. As Pastor said, when times like this come, we make God our refuge. Something like this happens, we go to God and say, God, I am yours. No matter what, I am absolutely, totally sold out to you. There's nothing that can take me away from this. God, I trust you with my whole life. I trust you with my whole life. Joseph, the next scene, you know what happens the next scene? Potiphar comes. He has embraced his life and said, finally realized, God, it's you. It's you. You got my good in mind. I yield. I surrender to you. When God saw that it was time, boom, he came from the prison to the palace in less than 20 minutes. From the prison to the palace in just enough time to shave and get changed. 20 minutes. Will you trust him for that? I submit to you that your hardships that you've gone through is because God has an amazing future for you. And you're not like any ordinary man. You're not. But God is counting so much on you. And if you go only look at his heart, there's so much worship, there's so much praise, there's so much ministry that God has for your life. And so he needs you for you to go through that. He needs you to go through for that. You are that close to your destiny. And it's up to you if you're walking through your destiny or not. Will you embrace what God has for you? Will you say, God, I don't care what I go through. I am totally determined to follow you. With my very last breath, I'm going to serve you and I'm going to follow you. And when you don't understand whatever is happening to you, will you still in that time press in and say, God, I am yours. I am yours. It doesn't take a man to become bitter. It doesn't take any man, any size of a man to become bitter or discouraged or resentful. Nothing. The world can do that. They do it all the time. But it takes a real person of character, strength, purpose to actually press in and say, God, I'm not going to let this stop me. I'm pushing in. I'm pushing in. And here I am. I'm yielding myself again to you, fresh and new. Whatever you have for me, I surrender. I surrender. I surrender. And I'm closing with this. Remember the story that Jesus, the saying that Jesus said, you want to find your life? Lose your life. Remember that? Believe it or not, but God is actually after, quote unquote, killing you. Because only when you are dead, meaning totally surrendered to you, to God, totally yielded to God, you can come into a full, full place, destiny that God has for you. So why fret? Why kick against those things? Embrace the process. Say, God, it's a hard pill to swallow, but God, I know that you are good. And all this is for my good. I can't see the picture right now, but God, I know that your plans for my life are good. You got good in store for me. So God, I press in and I surrender to you. It's a life of surrender. It's a life of yielding. And God can make beautiful things out of a yielded vessel. He can make beautiful things. That anointing oil that I described, it was an incredibly expensive oil. At one point, cinnamon was traded for gold. It was that valuable. And that's only one portion of that. There's so much treasure that God has invested in you. And he has such high dreams and such high hopes for you. It would be a shame for you to throw that away and settle for comfort instead of for best. Don't settle for comfort. Don't settle for comfort. Pursue God and settle for his best for you. Don't settle for comfort. Because there's so much more for God. I want to pray. If you feel that you're going through that, I want to declare that there will be a new tenacity in you to endure the process. Whatever you're going through, God is totally in control. Totally in control. He knows exactly what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. And nothing that happened to you took him by surprise. Nothing. 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 He knew it way before he showed up. But he's counting on you. He wants to release you. There's a destiny that awaits you. And he's got to prepare you for that. Let's stand, Pastor.